Well, good evening, good day, good whatever. This has been a long marathon among the stars. So let me share with you what I feel are the important reasons why it makes sense to explore. We learned today that it's very important to explore inside ourselves first, but it's also very important to explore all the space around us. And the reasons why we do that are many. To start with, exploring can provide maybe some answers to the big whys questions. Are we alone? Where are we from? Exploration is also important from a political point of view. It's a way to show leadership. It's a way to show national prestige. Exploration is a plus. We discuss about that many times today. Is a way to develop new technologies because there are challenges that we need to face and solutions we need to find. And that has an important plus also from a commercial point of view. Space is for sure a way to develop economy. Exploration is also an important connotation for international cooperation. Let me just mention the International Space Station as a clear sign that people can come together and work peacefully on a common project. Today is very important to recall that exploration is important to stimulate the new generation interest in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. And last but not the least, we need to explore and to find new possible places for humankind to live and work in another universe. So the starting point is really very close to us. It's the International Space Station in low Earth orbit. I don't need to recall this beautiful realization of cooperation and engineering. People have been living there for many years now, and this will be the starting place for the generation to come that will continue to explore the Moon and then Mars. And in fact, exploration is a stepwise approach, and it really makes sense to, let me say, export our knowledge, our technology, a little bit farther away toward, Moon and Mars, as I said. And the different space agencies came together years ago, and they put together a plan that will bring humankind on the surface of the Red Planet in the next decade. There are new actors that are coming into the stage. First of all, the political people. There is a clear indication by NASA that it's time to go back to the Moon and from there to move farther toward Mars. To do that, we need to develop new transportation system, Orion, to make it's the important new transportation means that will allow us to develop a new infrastructure in orbit around the Moon. Among the new players, China, the Emirates, and also all the commercial people, private people that believe so much in what they are doing that they are really offering new technical solution to accomplish these goals. Not just companies, but also states, also governments. We shall all remember that Luxembourg, that is, a little state, is devoting important resources because they believe that space is rich of resources and it makes sense to go there and take benefit. I mentioned already the NASA vision, go back to the moon. Indeed, in a very short time frame, the intention is to bring people back to the moon and the first women in the next few years. The calendar 2024, now maybe there could be a little delay, but let's say that we are going there. And to go back to the moon, I already mentioned, implies the need to develop a new transportation system. And let me recall that Europe is really providing a big part of the system with the European Service Module that is developed precisely while we are talking. This system is designed to carry four astronauts in deep space, and the first flight without the crew is planned for the next year, with the second one following in 2023 for a flyby, and finally the landing in 2024. So I promise you in the title of my little presentation that I was going to comment the many reasons why it makes sense to go to the moon. Well, for sure, the moon is reachable, is very close, is a possible destination for humankind. Moon has a high scientific interest because it may allow us to understand the evolution of our planet. It's full of resources. In the next slide, I will show you which ones. And is a perfect place where we can validate the enabling technologies and the capabilities. So not just technologies, but we mentioned before the soft skills that will be needed to sustain the first crewed mission to Mars. And here is a picture that I love a lot. It summarizes the main feature that we as engineers have to accomplish when we design any possible building blocks for the lunar surface infrastructure. So it was already mentioned today that people will have to adapt to a lower gravity level, 1.6 G. On the moon there is no atmosphere, so we will for sure need to bring all the oxygen we need from Earth, or even better, we will have to extract it from the regolith. You see here the indication of the composition, chemical composition of the regolith. Moon is indeed full of oxygen. It's rich of silicon that we can use to produce solar cells. Is rich of iron and aluminium that can be used as a structural element, and so on. We will have to face and find solution for really temperature extremes, but if we dig 1 meter under the lunar surface, then we will have almost a stable low temperature, much easier. So this is one of the many reasons why we are looking at lava tubes as possible places where to install maybe inflatable habitation module. There is no magnetic field, so all the radiations, unfortunately, are impacting the lunar surface, and so for sure we will need to provide radiation protection for the astronauts. Are we going directly to the lunar surface? No, we are stepping first in orbit around the moon with this beautiful LOG-G facility. And why we are doing that? Why it makes sense to do that? Because again, the idea is to validate in orbit the technologies that will be needed for the long trip to Mars. A travel to Mars will last 6-7 months, and so learning how to behave, how to live in orbit around the moon make a lot of sense. Also to study all the issues related to physiology and to psychology aspect. There we will validate the system that we plan to use to protect the astronaut against radiation, but also we are currently designing new habitats that are really human-centered, because in such a distant place, the astronaut will feel the need to feel at home somehow, and we have the obligation to do our best to guarantee that. In orbit around the Moon, we will also validate all the subsystems required for long-term missions, so life support system, in situ diagnostic and maintenance capability. From there, we will be able to teleoperate a robotic system that will operate on the lunar surface, and finally, we will take benefit of any scientific possible mission. Let's have a quick look at the architecture of the Lunar Orbiter Platform. Will be a much smaller space station with respect to the current one in orbit around the Earth. So in fact, it will be not permanently inhabited at the beginning, but will be just visited for missions up to 30 days duration. The first elements are shown here. So the first element will be this power and propulsion module, together with this habitat and logistic outpost. And I am proud to say that we in Thales Alenia Space have the responsibility to design the primary structure of this module. Not just that, but we recently got the contracts for the two subsequent elements, the International Habitation Module. We are prime contractor as Thales Alenia Space in Italy, and as Thales Alenia Space in France, we got the responsibility to design the Esprit module. You see here a possible configuration of the internal architecture. To land people again on the lunar surface, NASA has assigned three contracts in parallel to Dynetics, SpaceX and Blue Origin, and again our company Thales Alenia Space is the only non-American company that is involved in this challenging design exercise, and we are currently designing, as you can see here, the pressurized module that will host the crew. Well, it's not easy to sustain life in such an hostile environment. In this picture, I wanted to recall the very minimum building blocks that will be required for the initial lunar surface infrastructure. You see here the lander, you see here the habitat. To protect the astronauts against radiation, we will need to cover the habitat with the local regolith, or, as I said, to install inflatable habitat inside the lava tube. A very strategic element is the pressurized rover that will allow the astronaut to perform exploration away from the base. In technical way, we say short sleeve, so being protected, being hosted inside the pressurized volume. And then for sure we will need telecommunication and navigation satellites to connect the astronauts back with Earth, but also to oversee the robotic operations on the lunar surface. And here just some glances about our technologies. We are currently developing not only rigid pressurized modules, but also inflatable, but also deployable modules. This type of solution has the big advantage of allowing a launch of three elements that are launched in a pack, let's say, fashion, And once in space, they will be unfolded and will reach the full volume operability. This is the pressurized rover that we design. Is a sort of summa of technology. Each wheels can steer independently. Now, I don't want to bother you with technical details, but we are very proud of this design. Not only pressurized elements, but we need green. We are currently developing many activities to put together and the possibility to provide the possibility for the astronauts to grow and enjoy some salad that they will produce inside the base itself. In the picture here, you see a reference to the Eden project that we design and operate in Antarctica to test the technology. And here you see a possible greenhouse that we developed in collaboration with the University of Arizona a few years ago. A sketch of what it could look like. The first seed of the moon surface infrastructure, with the recall that we have to cope with all these criticalities. So low gravity, lack of atmosphere, cosmic radiation. It was already underlined today that regolith is very abrasive, and so each mechanism will have to be protected. And on the moon, we have extensive eclipses, and so it's very critical, let's say, all the concept of power production and distribution, especially if we for the very first mission, we cannot think of a nuclear solution and we have to stay and work with a photovoltaic solution. Then we have to show that we are intelligent and maybe we can handle that easier at the lunar pole than at the equator. Not just engineering, but when we design a crewed mission, for sure the critical ring of the chain is the human factor. I like to show this point in a very pictorial way. This is the Earth view from the International Space Station. So when the astronauts face out and look outside from cupola, well, they can recognize the blue planet. They can recognize countries. This is Italy. It's very easy. So they don't feel so far away from, their family, from their normal life. This is the Earth view from the moon. The perspective is already different. The distance is there. But when people will stand up on the Martian surface, this is the view of the Earth that they will have. Nobody. No human being has ever experienced such a loneliness. And so for sure the psychological impacts that the astronauts will have to cope with are still to be discovered. For sure our journey is ongoing, and so it's really important to put together all our knowledge and to find together the best way to travel farther from our cradle. And with that, I thank you for your attention, and I'm ready to take any questions or consideration that you might like to share.